Good evening. It's my very great privilege and pleasure to welcome and to introduce Ambassador Rabinovich this evening. Ambassador, as I read your book and came to the point where you describe your close relationship, working relationship, and friendship with Yitzhak Rabin, I thought to myself, what a tremendous challenge to write a biography of someone whom you worked alongside and lived alongside for a while. And you did an amazing job. And you can tell by the plaudits, President Bill Clinton has thanked you, said it's amazing you could cover so much ground in so few pages. Henry Kissinger has called your book a thoughtful and extraordinarily comprehensive account of a significant leader, and there are many, many more. The ambassador is a professor, is president of the Israel Institute. He is a professor emeritus of Middle Eastern history and the former president of Tel Aviv University, and he is distinguished global professor at NYU as well as a non-resident distinguished fellow at the Brookings Institution. He served as Israel's ambassador to the United States and chief negotiator with Syria from 1992 to 1996. He has authored numerous books and other academic works, including The View from Damascus and The Lingering Conflict, Israel, the Arabs, and the Middle East. Over the years, the ambassador has held several public positions in Israel and in other countries. He is currently chairman of the board of the Don David Foundation, a member of the advisory council of APCO Worldwide, chairman of the advisory board of the Wexner Israel Program, a member of the Trilateral Commission, a member of the International Advisory Board of the Brookings Institution in Washington, and a member of the International Advisory Board of the American Interest. Amazing. So we are delighted that you could join us, Ambassador, and it's my pleasure to welcome you.
Thank you for the kind introduction, and thank you for the advance credit. As you could gather from the introduction, this is a very personal book. It is my 12th book. The 11 preceding books were history, political history, diplomatic history. I never wrote a biography before, and I never thought I would write a biography. Writing a biography takes an entirely different set of skills that I was not sure I had. You don't just write the history of a person, but you have to describe the life of the person, the persona, the personality, make it come alive, weave it into the history of the period. It is very different from writing standard history. But when the editors of the series at Yale University Press approached me and asked me to write Rabin's biography, I felt I not just had to do it, I wanted to do it. Because I am a professional historian, and I was a friend of Rabin. I worked very closely with him. I knew him from nearby, and I felt that I could do a decent job in describing his life and keeping his legacy alive, so I gave it a try. And what happened during the course of the research and the writing was that I discovered that I thought I knew Rabin. That when you really research one's life, you go into the history of the family, you go into the character of the parents, and then into the details of so many things that, or so many chapters in Rabin's life and career, that you realize that, yes, you basically knew him, let's say, in black and white, but not in color. And when I completed the book, I thought I also knew him in color. Now, it is a biography. It's not a hagiography. Hagiography is a kind of biography that is oftentimes commissioned, that is limited to praising the person, to present the person and his life only in glowing terms. No. Rabin was a leader of flesh and blood. He had many good qualities, many admirable ones, but he also had weaknesses, and he also made mistakes. And there were a few problems along his career, and I describe them in the book, because the whole point is to give the reader and to have on the shelf, the history bookshelves, a true portrait of the man and his legacy. So I will mention some of these character traits, the good ones as well as the bad ones, or least good ones, a bit later in my presentation. What I'd like to do is talk first about the death and life of Rabin. I will explain the term in a minute, about his life, about his career, and about the legacy and the significance of the assassination. So the death, why do I call it death and life? Because the first thing that comes to mind, I think, is the assassination. November 4, 1995, an evil act that changed Israel's history and, of course, terminated Rabin's life. And assassinated leaders, assassinated political leaders, oftentimes are remembered, first of all, through the assassination, and oftentimes in glowing terms, because the assassination endows the life with a special significance. Think about JFK. A charmed life, a very brilliant, glowing White House, a great promise. They were cut short, and people always remember JFK as in these terms. Lincoln, Martin Luther King, Gandhi, quite a few other examples of important great leaders who were assassinated and who are always remembered both for their death and life. Now, remembering the death and thinking about the significance of the death does not take away from the significance of life. Some assassinations don't endow the character, the protagonist, with a significant life. Think about one of the most famous assassinations in history, that of the Austrian Crown Prince that triggered World War I, Archduke Johann Ferdinand. Well, we know that he was assassinated. We know that it was a tremendously important event, but what do we know about his life? What do we know about his accomplishment? Not much, because there's not much to be known. But when we think of Rabin and of Lincoln and of Kennedy, of Martin Luther King, of Gandhi, there's a whole history of acts and deeds and statements that endows the life itself with a great deal of importance. So this is how we remember Rabin, the assassination, of course, but also the life and the accomplishments. Let me say a few words about Rabin the person. Rabin was not a charismatic leader. He was not a Moshe Dayan. We all remember Moshe Dayan and how charismatic he was. Rabin was not endowed with that kind of charisma. Rabin had authority, and he had other, call it, elements of his personality that made him a very authoritative leader in Israel, but he did not have a charisma. He was also a very private person, very shy, not a natural politician. The business of politics, shaking hands, pressing the flesh, making the phone calls, whatever politicians do in order to canvass votes and get into office and staying in office, Rabin was not comfortable with. Let me give you an example of how Rabin recruited me to my positions, first as a negotiator with Syria and then as ambassador. So we knew each other. He was, of course, 20 years older than me, but we were neighbors and we were socially friendly, and we had a professional relationship, because he liked to talk to about the Middle East, and I was one of the people he would talk to about the Middle East. And when he was elected prime minister the second time in 1992, he invited me to his home on a Shabbat at 11 a.m. And I thought I knew what he had in mind, because he could offer me or ask me either to to become the chief negotiator with Syria or the ambassador to Washington, which was something that had been discussed before. So I came in. Rabin was not great in small talk, so smiled, and then he said, the first thing that is on my mind nowadays is I have to find a new chief negotiator with Syria. Do you know someone who knows the subject matter and has a public profile in Israel? Well, obviously he didn't want a negative answer, but it was awkward for me. I mean, what would I say? Yes, I can recommend myself. So I said, well, I could think of a couple of names. He said, no. I'm interested not in a couple of names, in one name. I said, I'd be very happy to do it. So he said, oh, I'm so delighted, and this is how I was recruited. Now, Rabin himself told the story when he came to Washington for the first time on my watch in March 1993 in a large dinner that we held for him and his wife, Leah. And of course, what you call the whole of Washington was there. And he stood up and he told the story. Why did he do that? Because he himself was ambassador in Washington from 1968 to 1973. And he knew the rules of the game in Washington. In Washington, being the ambassador of Israel can be a wonderful position with one condition. Washington, official Washington, needs to know that you are the channel to the prime minister. If you are the channel to the prime minister, then you play a very important role. If they find out that you are not the channel to the prime minister, you can go to cocktail parties and play tennis and do other things. So this was Rabin's way of telling Washington that I was a confidant, that I was the channel to him. That's Rabin. He didn't think like so many politicians just about himself, but also about his ambassador, and he wanted his ambassador to do well. So he was shy and reserved and so forth, but well, he was a mensch, and he demanded loyalty, but he also gave it. So working with him was a unique experience, a unique privilege. Of course, he was also a very wise and experienced man, total recall, and it was a life-forming experience, obviously, for me. And his loss, the assassination, was, in addition to recognizing the huge negative impact for Israel, was first and foremost, for me, a personal loss. Rabin, I thought for a while when I was writing the book, I thought for a while about naming it not Yitzhak Rabin, soldier, leader, statesman, but native son. Why native son? Because Rabin was the quintessential Sabra. Grew up in Tel Aviv in the midst of the labor movement establishment, where both his parents were very active, went to labor movement schools, then went to the Keduri Agricultural High School in the Jezreelon Valley, which was the best school in the country, and was the class valedictorian. Turned out in high school that he was a very smart student, which had not been the case in elementary school. So much so that he was given the British High Commissioner's Prize when he graduated, and he was to use the money going to California to study water engineering at UC Davis, because what Rabin wanted to do when he was 18 years old was to become a water engineer and help in the development of State of Israel, or what was to be the State of Israel. But this was the middle of World War II. This was not the time to go to study in California. This was the time to join military action, and he joined the Palmach, the elite unit of the Haganah, the embryonic army of the Jewish community in Palestine. And then it turned out that he had an innate, natural gift for military affairs. He was a very able military planner, and the head of the Palmach, Yigal Alon, identified it very soon and made him his deputy and chief operating officer. And Rabin rose quickly through the ranks, and when the War of Independence broke out in late 1947, he was given the very important task of taking the convoys to Jerusalem. Those of you who traveled to Jerusalem by road must have seen the remains of some of the vehicles that were destroyed during the siege of Jerusalem. And his task was to try to, first of all, guarantee that some of these convoys would get through. Secondly, to capture the hills over commanding the road to guarantee safe passage to Jerusalem, and finally to fight in Jerusalem itself. He was a brigade commander at that point, very young, 26 years old. He lost half of his brigade. I mean, the fighting was ferocious, and the rate of losses was tremendous. And this searing experience formed him for the rest of his life. Not just a special bond to Jerusalem, but also a sense that the IDF, the Israeli army, had not been sufficiently well prepared by the political leadership for the war. And he vowed that he will devote his life to making sure that this did not happen again. So that at the end of the War of Independence, he stayed in the army and rose through the senior ranks to become a general and then the head of the IDF, being the chief of staff of the IDF from January 1964 through the Six-Day War of 1967. Both as a general in charge of instruction and planning in the IDF, as deputy chief of staff and as chief of staff, he played a huge role in building and preparing the IDF for that ultimate test, the Six-Day War, that forever transformed Israel's position. At the end of the Six-Day War, Israel became a regional power. The Israeli-American relationship was transformed by that war. Israel was considered to be a small, dependent state before. It became a regional power and an important ally of the United States, a military power to be reckoned with and a reliable one. But the war was not just a blessing. We also became encumbered with the territories that we captured in 67. So the territories captured in Egypt became the asset for making peace with Egypt. The same did not materialize with regard to Syria. And of course, the big debate that divides Israel to date is the debate over the future of the West Bank. Is it, I say, the West Bank? People on the right wing in Israeli life would take exception to that. This is not the West Bank, this is Judea and Samaria. This is the original land of our fathers, and it's ours, and it's our mission to make sure that the original state of Israel is enhanced by incorporating the West Bank. And the left, center and left wing in Israel have a different opinion. Whatever one's political views are, it is an irony of history that Rabin, who captured the West Bank as chief of staff in 1967, was killed because he was willing to give back at least part of it in order to come to a peaceful settlement with the Palestinians to have what we call a political diplomatic solution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. I'm not saying two-state solution because Rabin, to his last day, did not use the term Palestinian state. Last speech that he gave on the subject in October 1995 in the Knesset, he said Palestinian entity less than a state. Now this may have been a bargaining position because final status negotiations were yet to take place. And of course, an experienced negotiator knows that you do not begin the negotiation by giving the other party the bottom line. What leverage do you have left? So it will remain an open question of what Rabin really had in mind with regard to a final status agreement. But he definitely was determined to put Israeli-Arab relations on a different track. This is 1992. When he became prime minister second time. What happened first time? So Rabin was ambassador in Washington, 1968 to 1973. He was a very effective ambassador, a great relationship with Henry Kissinger and with President Nixon. And he came back in 1973 and he wanted to go into politics. And he was to be on the Labour Party list in the October 1973 elections. Only there were no elections in October 73. There was the October War, the Yom Kippur War. And elections were postponed to December 1973. He was elected to the Knesset, and he became a minister in Golda Meir's cabinet. But then in 1974, Golda had to resign because the soldiers who came back from the front were very unhappy with the political leadership. There were massive demonstrations, and she and Moshe Dayan had to resign. And the Labour Party had to select another leader, and they decided on Yitzhak Rabin, because he was a war hero with very good reputation, and his reputation was not tarnished by the October War because he was not part of the government at that time. And so, in 1974, he was elected prime minister at a young age of 45, the first Sabra to become prime minister. And what I call his first term, so 1974 to 1977, policy success, political failure. Policy success, he played a very important role in normalizing life in the country, rehabilitating the economy and the IDF after the October War, and in signing with Egypt the interim agreement of 1975 that was the foundation for the peace made later in the 1970s. But politically, it was not a good term. He was young, he was inexperienced, he was, as I said before, a very awkward politician, and he had yet to learn the ropes. And it was not a good term, and he resigned in 1977. People assumed that this was the end of his political career. But in the 1980s, he became defense minister in a national unity government. He did that for 6 years, and he was a very effective minister of defense and a very authoritative one. And the public came to appreciate him and to see him as Mr. National Security. And it was the combination of this stature as a military or national security authority and his character that bought him his standing with the Israeli public. The public appreciated what everybody appreciated about Rabin. I witnessed firsthand the way his relationship with President Clinton developed in the 1990s. And I could see what Clinton appreciated. Of course, he saw in Rabin a smart man, a man who understood the subject matter, a courageous leader who could make tough decisions. But he mostly appreciated the directness, the honesty. Rabin could say no to Clinton, but when he said yes, it was a yes. And the Israeli public came to see that these same qualities. When Rabin was Minister of Defense and the IDF would sustain casualties in South Lebanon, Rabin would go on national television, would look you at the eye and would say, yes, we had 3 or 4 casualties in South Lebanon, and as Minister of Defense, I am responsible. Not words that you always hear from presidents either in Jerusalem or in Washington, but captivating for the Israeli public. The people appreciated this honesty. And in 1992, when the Labour Party realized that Shimon Peres could not win an election in Israel, they switched back to Yitzhak Rabin. And Rabin became again leader of the Labour Party and won the national election and became prime minister a second time 15 years later. This is significant, because Rabin felt from the first day that this is not a happenstance, and if whoever makes the decision up there chose him to become prime minister, gave him a second chance 15 years later, he would be there not to enjoy the trappings of power such as they are in Israel, but to make a difference. And the difference would be to normalize Israel's relationship with its immediate neighbors in order to face the greater dangers in the East, Iran and at that time Iraq. So we keep hearing today about Iran and the danger it poses to Israel. Rabin saw that in more than 20 years ago, and his idea, which he shared with the Clinton administration, was that we should sort out our relationship with our immediate neighbors, the Syrians, the Palestinians, the Jordanians. We already had peace with Egypt, and then we could face together the major danger from the East. And there were two options, the Syrian option or the Palestinian option. None of them was very attractive because peace with Syria meant that we had to get off the Golan Heights, and peace with the Palestinians meant that we would have to give up part of the West Bank. Both of them very painful choices to be made, but Rabin was ready to do that. This is what made him a statesman. And this is the third part of my book, soldier, leader, statesman. A statesman, is someone, a leader, who can make these tough decisions, who can also go against his own grain. If you spoke to Rabin in the 70s or the 80s, shaking hands with Yasser Arafat or making concessions in the West Bank was not something that he would entertain. The general officer commanding of the Northern Command in Israel to think about getting off the Golan Heights for peace with Syria in the 70s and 80s, he would not have thought about that. But in the 90s, he did. And it was this ability to see what needed to be done, the courage to make the decision, and the ability to carry the Israeli public with him, were all these together combined to make him the international statesman that he was. But he paid for it with his life. Why did the assassin, a man called Yigal Amir, decide to assassinate Rabin? There were many in Israel, who disagreed violently. People who, as I said, felt that there was a religious bond to Judea and Samaria, or that it was, in terms of national security, too dangerous, that it making a deal with the Palestinians was a careless act. It was a point of view, but unfortunately, it produced a wave of incitement that had not been preceded before. Not just by politicians and not just by third-rate journalists, but also, I'm afraid I have to say, rabbis. There were rabbis in the settlements, and there were rabbis, Orthodox rabbis in the United States, that issued opinions that basically authorized Rabin's assassination. The law of the informer and the law of the pursuer, which were issued as opinions by rabbis, and the pursuer and the informer in Jewish history is punishable by death. So it was not just an incitement against the government, not just a call to topple the government, which is legitimate in a democracy, but a direct incitement against the prime minister. Yet, Rabin, the police, the security service, did not entertain the idea that a Jew could kill the prime minister. The mindset, I cannot call it, but the mindset was that, yes, there was a danger and the prime minister had to be protected because a Palestinian or another Arab or an Iranian emissary could try to kill him, but a Jew? And the fact is that the Jew did. Now, Yigal Amir, the fanatic who did that, did it because he calculated correctly that Rabin was not just the author and the prime minister who got the Oslo process to work, but he was the prime minister who could continue it. Shimon Peres is regarded as the architect of Oslo, but Rabin was the only one who could make it work. And so Yigal Amir specifically decided that in order to stop the Oslo process, Rabin had to be killed. Now there's a very dramatic moment that I'd like to share with you. There was a video footage of the assassination taken. There was an amateur photographer with a video camera across the street who filmed the whole assassination. He didn't know what he was about to film, but he did. Now you may ask me in brackets, could not there be a man with a gun instead of the camera? Yes, there could. There were many security failures in that evening, and this was one of them. But in any event, he did not have a gun, he had a video camera, and we have the assassination on record. Now, Rabin and Peres were there in a peace rally in the town square of Tel Aviv, speaking to a large audience. And at the end of the evening, they both went down the stairs, a short short distance, to the cars. Halfway down the stairs, Rabin says to Peres, "You know, we have not thanked the organizers of the rally sufficiently. Let's go up and thank them again. Peres said, I'm tired, I'll go home. So Peres goes to the car and Rabin goes up to thank the organizers. And then you see Peres going down the stairs, and the camera focuses on the face of the assassin who was allowed to sit there. Why, we don't know, but negligence. He was sitting there. And you could see that the assassin is thinking, should I kill Peres or not? Now, we know what went in his mind. If I kill Peres, I don't get to kill Rabin, because if I kill Peres, then the security guards will either incapacitate me or kill me. So I'll wait, I'll spare Peres. So he spares Peres, Peres goes to the car and drives home. 2 minutes later, Rabin comes down the stairs and he puts bullet in his back, and Rabin arrives at the hospital basically dead on arrival. Tom Friedman, a very capable journalist, a columnist of the New York Times, wrote a very powerful piece a few months later called The Men Who Voted Twice. Yigal Amir was, of course, put in jail, was put into jail for, you know, the rest of his life, literally. But he did want to vote in the 1996 elections that Shimon Peres held against Netanyahu. And the Supreme Court decided that he had the right to vote, and he voted. And Netanyahu defeated Peres and became the prime minister. And Tom Friedman wrote this piece called The Men Who Voted Twice, once with a bullet and once with a ballot. And Tom Friedman's thesis is that this killed the peace process because Rabin was the only centrist leader who wanted to continue with the peace process, who could make it work. I'm not sure that he was right, because there were significant other attempts at the peace process later. Think about the 2 decades that followed. Shimon Peres himself, even Netanyahu, signed away 13% of the West Bank in 98 and talked to Syria. Ariel Sharon, the leader of the radical right wing, who when he became prime minister, pulled to the center and evacuated Gaza. Ehud Olmert, before him Ehud Barak, they all tried. Netanyahu gave the famous two-state solution speech at Bar-Ilan University and negotiated. So the peace process did not die with the assassination of Rabin. It just suffered a severe blow. But the real significance of the assassination, I think, is domestically, internally, in Israel, because a red line was crossed. And the assassination of the prime minister, the incitement, the fact that the rabbis who incited were not punished, the fact that Orthodox Jews in Israel did not go through the soul searching that they really had to go to, I mean the political leaders. And the result is that there are still radicals, there is hate. If you go through the Israeli social media and you read or you encounter the vocabulary that goes on in the social media, there are still radical rabbis in the West Bank who, for instance, call on soldiers to refuse to evacuate settlements, that is to say, to undo the very foundations of the IDF. All of that is still there. And Israel still faces these difficult decisions. The Trump administration may or may not put its famous peace plan on the table. The problem will not go away. We may have, or we will have another election sooner or later. We just found out a couple of days ago that we will not have an election in June. Of course, as we all know, there is a dark cloud over the head of Prime Minister Netanyahu. The next election is probably going to be not so much over the future of the West Bank, but over the issue of corruption and honesty in Israeli public life. But the West Bank is not going away. This remains the governing issue of Israeli life, and the debate over it and over Rabin's role in it will remain very important in our life. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador. Thank you for your words. Thank you for the book. I trust that there are many people here and who are joining us via live stream who have read the book. And there's so much in the book. And you spoke about some of Rabin's characteristics. I'm curious, someone who worked closely with him, who was a friend, what did you admire most about Rabin? What quality did you find the most inspiring as a leader, as a friend?
The honesty, the integrity, first. He was, no harsh words about politicians, but, and they are honest politicians, but his honesty was outstanding. The honesty, the integrity, the sum total of the qualities that made him a very credible person to the Israeli public or to world leaders that had to deal with him. Secondly, the wisdom, the smartness. He had a total recall. He was a very sharp analytical mind. And it was a pleasure to debate an issue with him, to discuss an issue. He was open to debate. You could challenge him. Typically, he would not, sometimes he would argue and, you know, say nothing, but the next morning you could see that he changed his mind. He was open to say, but these were, are the two qualities that I appreciated the most.
I was struck in the book, there's the beginning of the second part of the book, after you're talking about, I believe, the end of his first term as prime minister, and there's a section where you talk about his second chance. How aware, I mean, I know once he became, you talk about once he became prime minister the second time, he was aware of this as a legacy-making moment. But as he sort of ventured back into politics after he left the office of prime minister, how aware was he of this second chance that he had here?
Okay, so two things. One is, you know, one of the governing issues was his rivalry with Shimon Peres. Began in the 1950s, when Rabin was a senior officer and Peres was in the Ministry of Defense. You know, classic in America too, the generals and the people in the Pentagon. Over a variety of issues, but that was a very important rivalry. So Rabin would say, for me, being prime minister is an option, it's not an obsession.
As opposed to
Peres, for whom it was an obsession. For him, it was an option, the way he put it. I think that he loved being Minister of Defense more than being Prime Minister. Because as Minister of Defense, you didn't have to do the politics. And I could see he had something called the Security Forum, in which the Chief of Staff, the head of the Mossad, the head of the Security Service, a few other senior officers would come and discuss issues. He was in his element. These are the people he liked. Right. And that's what he liked. But, you know, like, he knew that the first term was not great. He felt that there was a great deal of injustice in what he had to go through, and he wanted to vindicate himself. So, obviously, he did want to become prime minister again. But what he really loved was being Minister of Defense.
So I love the thread throughout the book about this relationship or lack of relationship with Shimon Peres. And one of the parts of the book where it really comes to life, and I thought was fascinating, you know, today or tomorrow, there's a movie about Entebbe opening.
Oh, yeah.
And so this is a major part, I mean, it's a big story in Rabin's legacy. Could you talk a little bit about Entebbe and also the sort of give and take between Rabin and Peres there, and who takes credit and who didn't take credit? I mean,
it's even a bigger story because it also involved the Netanyahu family.
Correct.
So, It's a three-cornered story. So, yes. So here's a classic situation. Rabin is the prime minister, and Peres is the minister of defense. Peres has defense or national security experience as director general of the Ministry of Defense, but this was mostly procurement, the nuclear issue, not military affairs. And Rabin is the former great chief of staff. Minister of Defense, Rabin, you know, they contested the prime ministership after Golda's resignation, And Rabin won by 60-40. And Peres made it clear that if he does not become Minister of Defense, his 40% in the party will not vote for Rabin. Rabin had to accept that very unhappily. And of course, Peres did not want Rabin to deal directly with the chief of staff of the IDF. That was part of the tug of war. So the Air France plane is hijacked. It turns out that it first goes to Libya, then it goes to Uganda. And the question is, what do you do? Do you negotiate with the hijackers, or do you think of a military operation? Well, the idea of going all the way to Uganda and dealing with the hijackers there and with the Ugandan army looks, you know, exotic. But after a few days, it turned out that there was a prospect of an operation. And here, the tug of war begins, because once it turns out that there is a feasible scenario, Peres, as the Minister of Defense, pushes. And Rabin, as the Prime Minister and the man with ultimate responsibility, says, wait, I need to be 100% sure. I'm not going to send our elite unit and so forth to be killed in Entebbe. I need to make sure that this is going to work. So later, when the politicking begins, the Peres people say, oh, Rabin hesitated, Rabin objected, and Peres kept pushing. This is not a correct way of presenting it, because Rabin had the ultimate responsibility. And in fact, when the operation was launched, he deposited a letter of resignation with the secretary of the cabinet. Said, if it fails, I resign. So, and then of course you have the Netanyahu family aspect, because Netanyahu's older brother, Yoni, was commander of the elite unit that carried out the operation and was killed there. And part of the so-called Netanyahu legend begins there, with the death of the brother. Created also a sort of a special relationship between Peres and the Netanyahu family, not between Rabin and Netanyahu family. So you have a very complex triangle.
Right, and then it gets even more interesting, and I'm just looking at a question from the audience. You mentioned in your book, and we've talked about this book throughout the week, and the couple times I've talked about it, I was living in Israel the year of 94 through 96, and part of our rabbinical school, so we were there the year that, not only the year Rabin was assassinated, but the year leading up to it, where we would walk down, you know, King George Street on a Friday afternoon, and you would see these rallies going on outside the Prime Minister's home, the anti-Rabin and the, as you describe, in the keffiyeh or the SS uniform. But there is that story, I think of, what was it, somebody, Rabin was in some sort of, Netanyahu, excuse me, was in some sort of procession in the...
procession. Right. With a casket.
Right, and never sort of calls out that level of discourse, correct?
He walked in that procession, and there was a casket, and there was also the very ugly rally in Jerusalem, in the Zion Square, where Netanyahu and the leadership of the Likud stood on the balcony, mm-hmm. and it was a very ugly event. Some more moderate Likudniks like Dan Meridor and David Levy just walked out. Netanyahu did not. There is a very awkward moment every year. There is, you know, since Rabin is an assassinated prime minister, the commemoration is a state affair. And every year, on the around November 4, there is a memorial service by the grave, and the president comes and the prime minister comes. So Netanyahu comes. Rabin family is not exactly happy. And one day, Rabin's sister, a remarkable lady, Rachel, spoke up to Netanyahu and said, and we remember who stood on that balcony. It's very much still part of the Israeli debate.
Still a raw nerve, I'm sure.
Very much so, yeah.
So I'm just going to look through a couple questions here and from the audience in no particular order. So just dream with us for a moment. I know you mentioned in your remarks that, well, the conventional wisdom is that the peace process ended with Rabin's assassination. It's not exactly true. I mean, others tried to make it work, but if Rabin hadn't been assassinated, how would the Middle East look today? I mean, I know it's pure speculation, but what if...
First of all, there may have been a deal with the Palestinians. What Rabin actually preferred, he actually preferred a Syrian deal first. First of all, I don't know how many of you saw the play Oslo in Lincoln Center. Yeah, good theater, bad history. Yeah. By the way, I wrote my first and last theater review was written for the Jewish Review of Books on Oslo. If you can Google it, there were so many inaccuracies there. So. Rabin's first choice really was a Syrian deal. Now, this looks a bit ironic today because Syria is no longer a country right now, no longer a state. But at the time when the old man was alive, the father of the current president, it was a strong country with an authoritative leader. And if he wanted to make a deal, he could have made a deal. And he negotiated seriously, but never really crossed the line. So Rabin realized that he could not make a deal with him first. He had a lot of reservations about Oslo, but he felt that in the absence of a Syrian option, he had to do it. So I don't rule out the possibility that he and Arafat would have negotiated a deal by 99, because Oslo was finalized in February 94, and then 5 years were stipulated for negotiating final status agreement. And so by February 99, possibly, we don't know. Second, if the negotiation were to fail, I think Rabin would have navigated an interim agreement or something that would have stabilized the situation. So, you know, certain things in the Middle East don't have to do with us. We always are, in our own eyes, are always in the center of the world, but the world is sometimes moves on without us. So the Arab Spring, the fact that the United States and the world are less dependent on Middle Eastern oil, the fact that the United States under Obama opted out pretty much of the Middle East and quote unquote pivoted to Asia Pacific for a while, all of that had little to do with us. So the Middle East and of course the rise of Iran, the catastrophic invasion of Iraq by George W. Bush in 2003. Yeah, all these events also shaped the Middle East, but on the whole, would have been a better place with Rabin.
Yeah, I thought one of the revelations in the book when you were talking about just how close Rabin was to making peace with Syria, right? Until they came back and said no recognition or whatever they refused to do, Rabin was ready to go in, and yet I think about being in Israel at that time and just how much public sentiment was against returning the Golan.
Right. Right?
I mean, you could not look anywhere in the sky without seeing the sign, Ha'am Im HaGolan, right?
Right?
The people are with the Golan.
Right.
And yet Rabin was ready to sell the farm there, right? I mean...
Okay. Rabin, in theory, what Rabin did was... The problem in the negotiation, I was the negotiator. The problem in negotiation with Assad was that Assad said, I'm willing to make peace with Israel, but I will not tell you what kind of peace, what I mean by peace. First, I want you to commit to withdraw from the Golan fully. And our position was, you don't begin the negotiation by giving you what you want. You begin the negotiation, we don't rule out the possibility that it may happen, but we won't let you know. Negotiation has to be conducted normally and without diktats. And then things continue like this for several months until we got to the point where Oslo was about to be completed, and Rabin needed to know whether he did or did not have a Syrian option. So what he did was, in a meeting with Secretary of State Christopher, he told him, gave him a hypothetical, conditional willingness to withdraw from the Golan. I emphasize, hypothetical and conditional. and said, tomorrow when you go to Damascus, you have this deposit, but, he said it five times, remember, it's in your pocket, it's not, on, must not be on the table. Now, what I think Henry Kissinger or Jim Baker would have done with the deposit would not to take it out of the pocket, but would tell Assad, you know, I was in Jerusalem yesterday, I had a good conversation with Rabin, I think I'm beginning to see some movement, so give me something and I'll go back to Jerusalem. And then you have to decide that you stay. Kissinger spent in 1974 30 days negotiating just the ceasefire agreement between Israel and Syria, 30 days. Christopher was less patient, so he took the deposit and put it on the table. And Assad said, of course, in principle, yes, but. And then he had, you know, that many conditions. When Christopher came back, now you, let me open brackets here. In diplomacy, you have something known as one-on-one. Let's say the prime minister and the president meet, or the prime minister and the secretary of state meet. Presumably, it's called one-on-one, but it's always two-on-two because there are note-takers. And lucky me, I was the note-taker for Israel all the time. So I got to sit on all these great dramatic meetings, including this one. So the American note-taker was Dennis Ross. And as we walked out of the room into a larger meeting, I said to Dennis Ross, you know, I don't want to sound romantic or over-dramatic, but I could hear the wings of history in the room. Because basically Rabin gave Christopher the key to make an Israeli-Syrian deal. The next, 2 days later, Christopher comes back from Damascus. We convene again in Rabin's office, and he gives Assad's answer, and Rabin understands that he wasted the deposit. The answer is not good. On top of that, Rabin asks Secretary Christopher, so how long are you staying in the region? And Christopher says, we are leaving tomorrow because, or tonight, because it's August and it's vacation time and we all go to California. So that was the end of that.
There could have been peace if it wasn't vacation time.
Right? Well, I'm not sure that Assad was really ready to cross. No, let me just say that. You see, because Syria is a minority military dictatorship. And you can only justify a military dictatorship by having an external enemy. If you make peace with Israel, then who needs this regime? So I'm not sure. That's why Rabin said it's hypothetical and conditional.
So you kind of answered my next question, which is, you're, you know, shifting gears for just a moment with your experience in these negotiations. And we know that, you know, you report in the book, and you know, if you study this stuff, you know that Israel was having conversations with these countries for a while, and even today there's we had a speaker here who talked about hydro diplomacy, right? Israel sort of working in the water, mm-hmm. out of fields. What is it, and you sort of answered it just now with the need for an external enemy, but these Arab countries cannot utter the words, we recognize Israel's right to exist. What, why that?
No, Israel's right to exist is no problem. Israel is the Jewish character of the state of Israel. Israel is the nation-state of the Jewish people.
They can't get those words out.
Yeah. I need to complete what my earlier response. I said, why the Israeli public was so opposed? Because Assad was incapable of what we call public diplomacy. He refused to speak to the Israeli public. When we made peace with Egypt, President Sadat was a wise man and understood that you have to help Begin make peace, and he said, first I go to the Knesset and I speak to the Israeli public and I explain that we no longer are an enemy, and then Begin could give me back the Sinai, and he was right. Assad would not do that. Assad was a man with a much more limited horizon than Sadat. Now, Arabs, and by the way, many other people, find it very difficult to understand the complex nature of Jewishness. What is being Jewish? Is it a religion? Is it a peoplehood? Is it a nationhood? What is the relationship between an American Jew and the state of Israel and the land of Israel? And, you know, I have endless conversations with Arab colleagues, and the smartest among them find it very difficult to understand. So they're saying, okay, Egypt and Jordan are two countries that signed peace agreement with the State of Israel. They've accepted the State of Israel. The Palestinians, the PLO in Oslo, recognized the State of Israel. But if you say, we want you to recognize it as a nation state of the Jewish people, we cannot, this is, you know, I would be undermining the Palestinians, I would be giving the right to every Jew in the world to come here. That they refused, at least until now, refused to do.
You see that changing anytime soon?
I think it will, I don't know about soon, but it will change. You know, take Saudi Arabia. When Henry Kissinger, as Secretary of State, went to Saudi Arabia for the first time in December 1973, after the October War, at that time, Jews were not allowed in Saudi Arabia. Jews, not Israelis. So King Faisal, who was then the King of Saudi Arabia, of course, received the Secretary of State of the United States, but he had to make a comment about him being Jewish. So he says to Kissinger, Mr. Secretary, we welcome you here as a human being. And Henry Kissinger, never at a loss for words, said, some of my best friends are human beings. So this is Saudi Arabia. This is that Saudi Arabia, 1973. Today, Israel and Saudi Arabia have a relationship under the table.
Correct.
And the Saudis regard us as a partner in very important issues in the Middle East. So they're not ready to sign a peace yet, but they will get to that point.
So one more question, and it'll give you an opportunity to just reflect and wrap up. In your remarks, you mentioned that that the assassination had I'm either paraphrasing or quoting you exactly, had a devastating impact on Israel. So I'm wondering if you can say a little bit more about what that devastating impact was, and in the process, sort of wrap up the evening with your own reflections about this soldier, leader, statesman.
I think the introduction of violence into a political process is cancerous. And the incitement was bad enough. There were other ugly instances, but the high point of killing a prime minister, I think, brought violence into our political and public life in a very dangerous way. That's what I meant.
So I'll give you the last word. Summarize, tell us again what this life meant, right? What was, what's the legacy of Prime Minister Rabin?
The legacy, I think the most important part of the legacy is what I call peace with security. Rabin was a peacemaker, he was not a peacenik. He was not from Peace Now. In November 1995, after the assassination, there was the General Assembly of the Jewish Federations in Boston, where Rabin was to come, obviously did not. There was the evening, instead of the keynote presentation, it was a memorial evening for Rabin. I was on the podium, and Henry Kissinger came for that evening. And as speaker after speaker depicted Rabin as the great peacenik and so forth, Kissinger leaned over to me and said, Yitzhak was not a flower child. So. Because for Rabin, peace, in order to be positive for Israel, had to be embedded in security. And peace and security went together. That's the quintessential legacy.
Thank you. Ambassador, I want to thank you. I want to thank all those who joined us here. I want to thank those who are joining us via live stream. Ambassador, I hope you'll come back one day. I think you've got a great lecture about Henry Kissinger in you, and we look forward to welcoming you back. We want to thank you very much for your presence here. Have a good night.
Thank you.